be lamps unto yourselves, as all of you must work out your own liberation. Do you know these were the last words of Buddha? Hello students, we are discussing a very interesting chapter of thinkers, beliefs and buildings. We are discussing about the different faiths that the thinkers, that the philosophers of that time, including the philosophers outside, Greek philosophers also, and simultaneously contemporary, there was Mahavira and Buddha in India, and they were talking to us, and these were the final words of Buddha. Among the teachings of Buddha, there is politeness, there is honesty, there is being humble, and even the masters, they are advised to be humble with their servants, to share their delicacies with their workers, to assign work to their employees according to their health, according to their capacity, according to their strength, because the sanghas, the organizations which were set up by Buddha through the Buddhism, it was joined by the kings, by the Gahapatis, who were very rich, and other rich people who were there, as well as rich people, because they even gave donations to these sanghas, chaityas, monasteries, stupas, etc. So they joined it, and they were asked to be the lamp of yourself and work out for your own liberation, that we talked of yesterday, about the penance, about the self-indulgence. Correct? So these were very simple preachings of Buddha that attracted many people towards these beliefs, towards these thinkers. And many people joined these organizations, and there was rise of bhikkhus, that is male people who lived in the stupas, who lived in the structures made by the Buddhists, and they worked as the preachers of the Dhamma, the preachers of the religion, that is Buddhism. However, in the text, textual evidences, we come through the males, about the males that were bhikkhus. They lived there, they had nothing with them except a bowl in which they used to get the alms. And these alms, they used to get one or two bowl, not more than that. And if they get more than that, they have to distribute it with the others, they have to share it with the others. Later, in the later text, we also come to know the appearance of women. Because a very, very dear disciple, very close disciple of Mahatma Buddha, that is Ananda, once he told Buddha that why not we include women, if women wanted to become nuns, if they wanted to observe all these rules and which are given in the Vinayapitaka, about which we discussed yesterday, in the Vinayapitaka, the rules and the regulations of the Sangha, if they accept it, why not women are included in all these organizations, in these Sanghas and Stupas? So Buddha agreed, and you will be very pleased to know the first women that became bhikkhuni, that was ordained. That was ordained as bhikkhuni was his own foster mother. The foster mother of Buddha, that is, the name of the mother of Buddha was Mahaprajapati Gautami. So she was the first one, the first woman to be ordained as the first bhikkhuni in this organization. Correct? Now, in these organizations, in these sanghas, there was system of consensus. Do you know the word consensus means? Whatever decisions will be taken, they will be taken through the consensus, like consent. The consensus word is derived from consent, like in democracy, it works with the consent of many people. Otherwise, if there is a subject, if there is a point which is not being solved through the consensus, then it was solved through the voting. So this was a very smooth system of working in the sanghas, a very smooth working, and a proper distribution of things were there. We can see all these sanghas in near the stupas in Sanchi, about which we have talked a lot, in Beirut, and also in Sarnath. It is said that the relics of Buddha, which are kept in different stupas, they were very well, they were seen by Ashoka, a great ruler of the Mauryas, who adopted Buddhism, and after 200 years of Buddha, he distributed these relics to different people of different regions, of different states, to be distributed among them, and that they should make a structure on it with the relics of Buddha, and that would be a mark, a structure, a building of Buddhism, marking the growth and the progress of Buddhism in India. As I told you, it spread far and wide, not only in India, but even outside India, the religion spread. So through the structures, through the buildings, through these organizations, this religion was propagated, and it was very pleasant to know that even kings were coming up, the Gahapatis, the kings, they were coming up, and there were proper meetings, there were proper holdings of meetings, organizations by the people preaching Buddhism to most of the people. And we know that the religion is totally based on our moral values. There is no place for any ritual, there is no place for any costly ceremony. Like Brahminical reactions and Brahminical texts were proposing people to do all these things. Now, we also come through a term in the Buddhist text and in the other texts that is called the Chaityas. Chaityas are also the shrines, and surrounded by natural things like flowers, plants, trees. Beautifully made Chaityas are there, and these were the places, they were particularly the shrines. Having the four gateways, like we had discussed in when we were discussing about the Sanchi Stupa, four gateways, we had discussed about the Eastern Gateway and Northern Gateway. So the four cardinal directions, the four cardinal points were there, and in each of these buildings, there are the surroundings are filled with the greenery, with the gardens. Moreover, there are four gateways, and there is a shrine also where people used to chant the hymns and the rhymes that are written in Buddhist texts. And in the excavations, a number of railings made of bamboos, made of wood, have been depicted, have been excavated, and they separated the stupa area with that of the Chaitya or the Sangha, the separation between these two. So all these we studied through the texts that have been provided to us. Now we will also discuss one more stupa after Sanchi, because Sanchi we have discussed in the beginning. And then Amaravati Stupa, about which you must have read in your earlier classes, the Amaravati Stupa and Shah Ji Ki Deri, which is in Peshawar, Pakistan today. So we will talk about Amaravati. It also has four cardinal points, because I told you in all these Buddhist stupas and Buddhist structures, we have four cardinal points. You can see your NCRT page number 96, 97, 98, 99. In all these pages, it is given, which I am telling you. So Amaravati Stupa is there. In 1796, Colon Mackenzie, he began to write about it, because previously this Amaravati Stupa, it was brought before us in the form of ruins and remains. Because maybe like Sanchi Stupa, the credit of securing, otherwise it would have been the place of the museums in France and Britain. But thanks to the Nawab of Bhopal at that time, that they were able to save it and protect it, and asking the French and the British to take the copy of Plaster of Paris of all this, because they also wanted the gateway of it, as I told you in my previous lecture. So similarly, Amaravati Stupa, actually very surprisingly, it was destroyed by a local ruler in India. Okay, and when he saw that in Amaravati, the walls, the pillars, they contained small sculptures. It was beautifully carved, beautifully made, a very good quality stone can be seen over there. Different types of images can be seen. So a local ruler, he got it destroyed because he wanted to make his own palace. Do you know that this was not good for the heritage, for the cultural heritage of India, it was not good. Because H.H. Cole, he was a British official, he called it suicidal. That suicidal means we are destroying our own wealth, we are destroying our own heritage. Is it not so surprising? Correct? This Amravati came to us in the form of runes. In 1796, Colonel Mackenzie, he wrote about it, he studied the different parts of Amravati Stupa, whatever was available in the form of the remains and runes, he studied them, and then he also prepared a compilation of report. And do you know, students, this report was never published. Because 1796 was the year when Britishers were there in India, and the report that was prepared by Mackenzie was never published. We do not know about it, although he made this report. Yes. Then in 1854, Walter Elliot, he was the commissioner at Guntur. Guntur, that is Andhra Pradesh. The commissioner of Guntur, do it in your map work. So he, in 1854, he took some of the valuable things of Amravati Stupa to be protected, to be preserved, and he worked for that. And that is why, sir, otherwise if Amravati Stupa would have been in its original form, we would have studied in detail about Amravati, not about any other stupa, because it was such a beautiful stupa of that time. But because I told you, we got it in the form of runes, we received it in the form of remains, so we are not able to know much about it. Only a few people, they were after it, and who studied all these, who studied the inscriptions, who studied the different architectural facts about the stones, about the different inscriptions written on it, and then they base their study on all these evidences and then give it to us. Small stories, Jataka stories. The excerpts from the Jataka stories have been taken and they have been written. Buddha have been presented because he got enlightenment. We discussed it previously. And when he got enlightened, even then he did not present himself as a spiritual person or having a spiritual power. You know, there is a story that once a lady came to Mahatma Buddha. Her son died and she was crying in grief, and she brought her son to Buddha and asked Buddha to give life to her son. Okay. Buddha said, I will give life to your son, but first of all, you go somewhere else and bring something from such a house where nobody died. Nobody died at any time. So the woman, she searched different places, different houses, asking some arm from the house where nobody died. But she could not get even a house where nobody died. She came back to Buddha and she got the lessons, she got the teaching which Buddha wanted to give her, that it is a cycle of birth and rebirth. Even the theory continues today. So such type of stories, such type of preservations are there by the different thinkers, by the different philosophers and historians. Otherwise, if Amravati Stupa would have been there in its original form, it would have been a very remarkable piece of architecture with us. Tomorrow we will discuss further about the different teachings, about how Buddha told his followers or his disciples about the life, about his philosophical works. And we will also dwell upon that after Buddha, after he got Nibbana, that is, you know that how Buddha got Nibbana, there was a fire and he disappeared. It is said, it has been written in the stories, in the legends. So we will study that what happened to Buddhism after Buddha. It was divided into Mahayana and Hinayana. Who were Mahayanas, who were Hinayanas, and what were the aftermath of this religion? We will discuss it in the next lecture. Till then, a very goodbye from me.